embattled Philippine lawmaker Arnolfo Teves Jr. has been charged with murder in connection with the killing of Negros Oriental Governor Roel Degamo and 9 others last March. Mike Navallo now joins us with details. Mike, over to you.
Stanley, more than 2 months since the killing of Negros Oriental Governor Roel Degamo, Senate's main mastermind, suspended Representative Arnolfo Teves Jr., finally faces murder raps before the Department of Justice. Justice Secretary Jesus Crispin Remulla earlier, just a few moments ago actually, said the filing of the multiple murder and frustrated murder complaints is ongoing at the Department of Justice. The NBI officials led by NBI Director Medardo De Lemos was here a while ago and they turned over voluminous documents to the panel of prosecutors. The complaints are in connection with the assassination of Degamo and 9 others in his house in Pamplona, Negros Oriental on March 4. No less than Justice Secretary Remulla tagged Teves as the executive director behind the killings, along with his former aide Marvin Miranda, described as a casting director. 11 suspects, including Miranda, are now facing murder charges in court. Up until today, Stanley, Teves faced no complaints in connection with Degamo's killing, but he is facing other murder complaints for the 2019 murders in Negros Oriental and illegal possession of firearms and explosives, all of which are undergoing preliminary investigation here at the Department of Justice. He has remained outside the country since his trip to the United States in March. He was previously reported to be in Cambodia before seeking asylum in Timor-Leste. That asylum bid was rejected, but Teves is appealing the decision. Remulla announced Tuesday that Teves might return to the Philippines on Wednesday morning, citing a reliable source from the airport knowledgeable with flight details. But Teves earlier today denied he is going home. He called it fake news. And he said that Remulla should have asked him personally before making the announcement to the media. Now, Remulla answered that query, that statement, by saying that Teves actually already had a flight ticket to Manila or to the Philippines. But if he doesn't go home, his flight from the country can be taken as an indication of guilt. Authorities have yet to release a copy of the complaint, Stanley, but the earlier DOJ prosecutor's resolution indicting Miranda claimed there were 2 prior attempts to kill Degamo, allegedly orchestrated by Teves. One in December 2022 using a rocket-propelled grenade, and another one in February 2023 through a sniper during a mass wedding. On both occasions, a witness said Miranda explained to Teves over the phone why the assassination attempt failed. Remulla had also previously told reporters that 7 to 8 suspects pointed to Teves' involvement in the Degamo slay, with 5 suspects claiming they saw Teves' face through a video call with Miranda. Miranda himself allegedly escaped using a helicopter bearing the slogan Teves Cares. Now, if you call Stanley the other day, Remulla was explaining why there was a delay in the filing of the murder raps, and he was saying that this was because some of those who previously gave statements to the DOJ or to the NBI have now refused to cooperate with authorities with respect to the Degamo case. Stanley?
All right, Mike, does it follow that an arrest warrant will also be out against those charged?
Stanley, not yet, because right now Teves is facing a murder complaint here at the Department of Justice. Mm-hmm. So he will have to go through a preliminary investigation. The panel of prosecutors will have to decide if charges will be filed in court against Teves in connection with the murders and the frustrated murders. It's only when the charges are filed in court when the court can decide to issue an arrest warrant, assuming that he will still not surrender to authorities or he will not give himself up voluntarily to authorities. The others, Stanley, the 11 who are already charged in court, are already in the custody of the National Bureau of Investigation since a few weeks back, Stanley.
All right, Mike, have you gotten word from Attorney Ferdinand Topacio? What's his reaction to this?
Not yet, Stanley, but we did manage to talk to him yesterday. Mm. And also, he also gave a statement to Teleradio, or he gave an interview to Teleradio earlier today. And he has always been challenging the Justice Secretary, the NBI, to file the charges against his client. He has been questioning why it's taking weeks before murder complaints can even be filed against Representative Teves. He's questioning the lack of evidence against his client. But with respect to Teves' return to the country, he's saying that it's all fake news. It's not true that his client is returning to the Philippines.
And Mike, do you have any update as to the reports that he is, in fact, returning today? The airport officials and the Philippine National Police has been anticipating that possibility today. What's the new word on that?
no word yet, Stanley, except that Tevez has given a statement to the media. He has also given an interview saying that he's not returning today. But what we know from Justice Secretary Rimoli is that they know that a ticket has been purchased in his name going back to the Philippines. So it's not sure if he took the flight or if he did not, if that was just a decoy. But the last information that Justice Secretary Rimoli has is that Tevez is still in Timor-Leste. I think that's the last location where he was reportedly in before this reported return to the Philippines. So since there's no direct flight from Timor-Leste to the Philippines, Rimoli said it could be, or Tevez could be going through another ASEAN country before returning to the Philippines. But no information yet from the Immigration Bureau, no information from the Philippine National Police or any other authorities if Tevez indeed made that step back to the Philippines.
All right. Thank you so much for the report, Mike Navalio. Do keep us updated. The camp of Congressman Tevez, meanwhile, insists he is being framed for the murder of Governor Degamo. They claim the investigation was not impartial to begin with.
Hindi ko maintindihan na kung anong pinagsasabi na ng Secretary of Justice. So nakakatakot na po dyan eh. Kasi ang nangyayari po, talagang kalap pa sila ng kalap ng ebidensya, ha? Namimilit pa sila. At alam niyo po, katulad noon, nandun ako sa DOJ, kita ko sa sarili kong dalawang mata na si Secretary Rimoli ay kinakausap. Kinausap, galing sa tanggapan niya, yung byuda ni Governor Degamo, na si Mayor Janice. Kinakausap niya yung mga abogado ng complainant. Alam niyo po, kung nangyayari sa hukuman yan at yung huwes, ay kinausap yung kabilang party, eh kaya paparerecuse po agad yung judge na yun eh. Ngunit ang problema po, pagka pinarecuse nyo ang Department of Justice, sino pong mag-imbestiga? Nakakaasuka na po ang ginagawa na pang-frame up nitong ating mga mga tao na dapat sila ang nag-imbestiga impartially at sila ang nagdi-dispense ng justice dito.
Now, as for his congressional seat, the House Secretary General says expulsion remains an option if Tevez fails to show up at the House of Representatives. Tevez's 60-day suspension will end on May the 22nd.
Hindi natin masabi kung ano yung gagawin talaga ng Committee on Ethics on this. Kasi walang precedent eh, na after the 60-day suspension, ano mangyayari. In the end, it's really the whole membership who will have to decide.
State prosecutors file new charges against former Corrections Bureau Chief Gerald Bantag and his ex-deputy Ricardo Zulueta. The Justice Department says it found probable cause to charge them with harming two inmates of the New Bilibid prisons. The cases stem from Bantag's stabbing of two inmates last year when he was still prison's chief. Bantag faces two counts of physical and mental torture and two counts of serious physical injuries. Zulueta will be charged as an accessory. The two former prison officials and several inmates already face two murder charges over the deaths of radio commentator Percy Lapid and inmate June Villamor. Malacañang open to taking back control of the National Grid Corporation if necessary. Now, in a statement, the palace said President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. backs the Senate's inquiry into the performance of the grid operator, as well as the possibility of a security breach on the nation's power grid. Some senators were worried over the 40% ownership of the State Grid Corporation of China amid the maritime row between Manila and Beijing. The NGCP has refuted claims of possible Chinese influence in the operation of the country's power grid.
Unang-una ha, parate tayong focus dun sa 40%. Pero nalilimutan nating i-underline na 60% Filipino dyan. Full-blooded Filipino ang management at ang employees niyan, 100% Filipino. Pangalawa, itong presence ng foreign technical partner ng NGCP, sang-ayon yan sa terms na binid out ng gobyerno. Sila ho ang nagsabi kung ano yung mga terms ng concession ng privatization ho ng transmission at sumunod lang lahat ng bidders, including NGCP, na nanalo dun sa bid na yon. Hindi ho ito negotiated.
Senator J.V. Ejercito asserts there is a need to review both the NGCP and the Electric Power Industry Reform Act of 2001, or EPIRA. He says both have failed to fulfill their goal of bringing down electricity rates. He also calls for full Filipino control of the country's energy transmission system.
20 years after EPIRA's passage, what happened was the privatization took place, the privatization of the power plants, the Transco. But what happened? Our electricity remains still one of the highest rates in Asia. And the problem that we are facing right now, why foreign direct investments are going to our neighbors, no? Thailand, Indonesia, Malaysia, and even Vietnam, because of two things. That's weak infrastructure and high cost of electricity. So we have to review EPIRA.
Meanwhile, Senator Sherwin Gatchalian says the Philippine government should hire an independent third party to look into this matter.
It cannot be superficial audit because, to be honest about it, the NSC conducted its audit one time, but it's just going there looking at the system, doing visual audits, but that's not enough. We need to get experts from abroad, people who are experts in cybersecurity, people who are experts in the technical aspects. We have to remember, NGCP, it's the only one of its kind nationwide. It's a natural monopoly. We cannot have two transmission operators or two system operators. There's only one, no? Because of the nature of that business. And because of its natural monopoly status, as well as national security issues, it should have remained in the hands of government.
Philippine senators warned the NGCP franchise may be canceled if proven that it did commit violations. The Senate Committee on Energy has begun probing the cause of power outages that recently hit parts of the country. During Wednesday's hearing, senators say electricity issues should be immediately resolved to ease the burden of Filipinos.
Di naman natin sinasabing babawiin agad. Pero ang mga tanong, bakit ilang taon na walang audit sa performance ng NGCP? So, I would just like to remind you, we're not making a unilateral conclusion here without further studies. But RA 9511 is clear that in a franchise, we may amend, we may alter, and we may repeal your franchise if it is for the common good. In this light, through this hearing, we want to determine if NGCP has remained faithful.
Tama nga po kayo dyan, yung pong franchise na ipinigay sa kanila sa NGCP, it's just a privilege na pwede ko pong makansila yan in the event na nakitaan sila ng maraming violations. So far, may mga violations po talaga ang NGCP na it could be the reason na para makansila ang kanilang franchise.
The Philippine Energy Chief defends the renewable deal in the Malampaya gas project. Secretary Rafael Lutilla responded to objections by a former official of the state-run oil company who urged the government to take full control of the gas field. Alvin El Chico reports.
The new service contractor of the Malampaya Consortium plans to drill 3 exploration wells during the first years of its 15-year contract extension. This will cost around $90 million or roughly 5 billion pesos each well. The Energy Department says there is still an estimated 210 billion cubic feet of natural gas deposit. The new contract retained the old profit split, 60% for the government and 40% to the contractors.
What we have done here is to retain the previous split in order to allow the contractor some leeway in pursuing new opportunities in and around the Malampaya gas field.
But former PNOC President Ed Manyalak says the government should have taken over the project since the new service contractors have practically no experience in exploration.
Pwedeng kunin ng gobyerno kung may gustong umalis na service contractor na libre, hindi mo babayaran. So kung umalis ang Chevron noon at umalis ang Shell, oh, goodbye, pwede na kayo umalis, akin na lahat yan. PNOC, ikaw magpatakbo.
Dapat ganoon.
Ganoon.
Manyalak says while he respects the decision, he wants to raise some questions to President Marcos.
Ano ho yung basihan ninyo noong pinirmahan nyo yung approval, yung extension? Kasi nga, sinasabi natin, yung mga service contractor na yan, dapat may alam at may pera. O ano ho ba sinabi sa inyo? Was graft committed? You know, because somebody gave certain advantages to some undeserving entity causing losses for the government or the Filipino people.
Energy Secretary Rafael Lutilia says PNOCEC or the government in general has some financial limitations, making it impossible to take on the capital-intensive project.
We want the drilling to start as soon as possible. We cannot wait for 2024, because if it takes 3 to 4 years to drill successfully and then get the gas flowing, and when we start only in 2024, what is going to happen? Then we would have lost a lot of time.
Lutilia also insists that the new contractors have the technical and financial capabilities to undertake the project extension.
The operator and its personnel have shown their technical competence over the last 6 months by managing the decline of the gas supply and undertaking successfully a maintenance activity. This confirms the findings of the DOE last year on the operator's technical, financial, and legal qualifications.
Alvin Olchico, ABS-CBN News.
Consortium member Prime Energy thanks government for the renewal of the Malampaya contract. It commits to ensure a stable and cleaner power supply for the country. Prime Infra Chairman Enrique Razon believes the latest development will help the country achieve energy security and independence. Senator Sherwin Gatchalian calls for a Senate probe on the possible involvement of POGOs in human trafficking activities. This following the rescue of more than 1,000 individuals in Clark who are alleged victims of human trafficking. Gatchalian says the compound where they were rescued is suspected to be a POGO hub inside the Clark Freeport zone. He adds human trafficking syndicates could be using POGOs as a front to conceal their illegal activities.